The Falcon 9 is generally considered SpaceX's reliable workhorse, routinely entrusted with the responsibility of launching satellites, crew members, and cargo into low Earth orbit. However, its potential extends significantly beyond those boundaries. Most recently, the Falcon 9 carried out a high-profile mission, transporting a payload to the moon on behalf of NASA. How did the Falcon 9 accomplish this feat, and in what ways has SpaceX advanced this lunar payload? Furthermore, what are the implications for NASA? Let's dive deeper into today's NR Studio episode. SpaceX can be involved in launching a Falcon 9 rocket, transporting one to the launch pad, or picking up another at a port. As of mid-month, the Falcon 9 has already surpassed its own record, with a single booster completing 5 flights in just 9 months. Notably, booster 1067 has now reached the impressive milestone of being reused 25 times. Furthermore, SpaceX shows no signs of slowing down its progress. Their goal is to achieve up to 0 launches for each Falcon 9 booster. Additionally, by leveraging its growing expertise in booster reuse, SpaceX has significantly reduced the turnaround time between flights. In November alone, the company achieved an incredible milestone by successfully launching Falcon 9S twice in the span of less than a day, setting a new record for the fastest turnaround to date. SpaceX has successfully conducted nearly 0 missions with booster recovery intervals of 1 month or less, with all but 9 of these occurring in the past year alone. However, the narrative goes beyond this point. SpaceX is actively engaged in the recovery and reuse of payload fairings, which serve as protective casings for satellite payloads during their atmospheric ascent. Last month, the company proudly announced that its payload fairing had achieved its 22nd successful launch, setting another new record. At the same time, SpaceX's facility in Hawthorne, California, continues to manufacture upper stages for every Falcon 9 and Falcon Heavy mission. Within the past year, a total of 135 new upper stages have been constructed, each entailing an expenditure of millions of dollars, thereby achieving an average cadence of 1 mission and a new upper stage approximately every 2.7 days. Nevertheless, these are not the sole highlights as we assess the current situation. Recently, SpaceX Falcon 9 successfully conducted 2 lunar payload launches, thereby advancing humanity's enduring aspiration to return to the moon and establish a sustainable presence there. The mission encompassed the deployment of 2 payloads, specifically lunar landers engineered by Firefly Aerospace of the United States and iSpace from Japan. This signifies the inaugural occasion on which Falcon 9 has engaged in such a multifaceted mission. Although both Firefly and iSpace had earlier declared arrangements to deploy their lunar landers utilizing the Falcon 9 rocket, prevailing industry speculation suggested that these missions would be conducted on distinct launches. SpaceX anticipations were influenced by iSpace's preliminary airborne deployment of its lander utilizing a dedicated Falcon 9 rocket. Nevertheless, it was not until the previous month that iSpace disclosed its resilience lander would be undertaking the mission alongside Firefly's Blue Ghost 1. This dual payload intensified the significance for SpaceX, not only by guaranteeing customer satisfaction, but also by showcasing its reliability to NASA, particularly in light of the Falcon 9's second stage failure the previous year. Commencing the new year with an unprecedented achievement in booster reusability, SpaceX has designated booster 1085 for its lunar mission, thereby marking its 5th flight after successful deployments for Crew 9, GPS-3, SV-07, Starlink 105, and Starlink 677. Approximately 8.5 minutes post-liftoff, B-1085 successfully touched down on the drone ship Just Read the Instructions, signifying Jurdy's 107th successful landing and the 98th overall booster recovery for Falcon 9. The upper stage tasked with transporting the payload executed its separation approximately 65 minutes post-launch by Firefly Aerospace, subsequent to 2 propulsion burns. The upper stage executed a 3rd brief burn prior to deploying iSpace's resilience lander into space, approximately 93 minutes post-liftoff. Both landers were positioned into transit orbits around Earth, subsequently following unique trajectories toward the moon. Progress reports on their expeditions will be provided, and should they achieve success, this mission will signify a significant milestone in the realm of lunar exploration. Consequently, this mission is of paramount importance, not solely for SpaceX Falcon 9, but also for the enterprises responsible for the lunar landers, signifying a pivotal advancement in the realm of deep lunar exploration. The launch signified Firefly Aerospace's inaugural mission destined for the moon. The design of its Blue Ghost lunar lander was initiated subsequent to the company's selection as a participant in NASA's Commercial Lunar Payload Services program. The overarching aim of the CLPS is to enable NASA's lunar surface access without necessitating the development of landers or the acquisition of launch services. NASA has established numerous contracts with various commercial lunar payload services, CLPS providers, including Astrobotics and Peregrine, with Mission 1 and Intuitive Machines, IM-1, flights scheduled for early this year. The Blue Ghost possesses a dry mass of 69 kilograms and attains an approximate weight of 1,500 kilograms when fully fueled. It employs an amalgamation of MMH, hypergolic propellant, and Mon-3 oxidizer to energize the primary engine and thrusters during the expedition. It is engineered to transport 10 NASA scientific payloads to the lunar surface, marking the highest number of payloads manifested on a single lander within the framework of the Commercial Lunar Payload Services, CLPS, initiative. Joe Kearns, Deputy Administrator for NASA's Science Mission Directorate, stated that once the 10 instruments were sufficiently compact to be accommodated on a single lander, the agency sought a company capable of conducting all scientific operations within a mere 2 weeks, coinciding with a single lunar daylight cycle. Firefly, along with various other contenders, rose to that challenge. Kern remarked that they devised a highly credible mission strategy to conduct all the desired experiments using our instruments. In a pre-launch interview, Brigitte Oakes, the Vice President of Engineering at Firefly, stated that the organization has integrated insights gained from prior lunar missions. "We gleaned numerous valuable insights from our previous missions. We conducted a comprehensive and meticulous assessment of every lunar mission launched, regardless of whether it was undertaken by commercial entities or NASA. A considerable amount of insights were gained from that experience, which we subsequently refined and tailored to align with Firefly's model, incorporating additional product lines and drawing on the most effective strategies employed by our predecessors. Firefly incorporated insights and technology garnered from its Alpha rocket into the development of Blue Ghost 2. Please provide the text you would like me to rewrite. This organization possesses a wealth of profound wisdom, invaluable experience, and insightful lessons learned. Our company encompasses both rockets and satellites, establishing a significant synergy between these two divisions. There are numerous lessons to be exchanged," stated CEO Jason Kim of Firefly. "As we transition to a steady cadence with our Alpha rocket, many of the insights gained, particularly regarding reaction control propulsion, are applicable to our Blue Ghost lander. This is due to the fact that the ACS and RCS thrusters on the Blue Ghost lander are derived from the technology developed for the Alpha rocket. There is a considerable amount of intercommunication occurring within our organization. This instills a sense of assurance in programs such as Blue Ghost. As Firefly prepares for its inaugural landing attempt scheduled for March 2nd, Kim noted that a pivotal feature of this lander is the quartet of cup-shaped ends situated on the landing legs. The landing pads have been meticulously engineered to incorporate crumple zones. When one considers the texture of a honeycomb, its inherent crunchiness is an integral aspect of its architectural design. Upon impact, it will behave similarly to a car involved in a collision, intentionally crumpling upon landing. That encapsulates the essence of the design in question. The initiative, dubbed Ghost Riders in the Sky, is anticipated to require a marginally extended duration to reach the lunar surface, in contrast to the previous CLPS mission executed by the Houston-based Intuitive Machines. The IAM-1 flight duration spanned approximately 7 days from launch to touchdown. In contrast, the Blue Ghost lander required roughly 5 days for its mission. Upon reaching the surface, the operation is expected to continue for approximately 2 weeks, utilizing an array of instruments. These include the Lunar Planet Back, LPV, a sample collection tool developed by Honeybee Robotics, the Lunar GNSS Receiver Experiment known as Lugari, spearheaded by the Italian Space Agency within NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center, and the Regolith Adherence Characterization, RAC, from Aegis Aerospace, designed to investigate the adhesion properties of regolith across varying materials. The landers are engineered to endure a few hours of nighttime, allowing them to capture the sunset in various regions enveloped in lunar darkness. Beneath the Blue Ghost lunar lander, nestled within a meticulously crafted payload canister, lay iSpace's lander, aptly named Resilience. This marks the second occasion on which the Japan-based division of the company has initiated the deployment of a lunar lander. The inaugural launch endeavor, Hakuto or Mission 1M1, was conducted as a dedicated flight on Falcon 9 in December 2022. However, it ultimately resulted in an unsuccessful landing attempt in April 2023. During a pre-launch interview, Ron Guerin, a former NASA astronaut and current CEO of iSpace USA, attributed the initial failed landing to software glitches. He said the radar altimeter recorded a significant increase in altitude as they approached the target crater, causing the lander to misjudge its position in the mission profile. The lander then made what it thought was a soft landing. However, it actually came in about 5,000 meters above the crater floor, where it remained in a stalled state until it ran out of fuel and eventually crashed. We fixed all the software issues. This time, we didn't descend to the depths of the crater, which significantly increased the confidence level, Guerin said. For Hakuto, our mission 2, dubbed Never Quit the Lunar Quest, the rugged lander is set to land in the Morphogorus region, also known as the Cold Sea, located in the northern hemisphere of the moon. The mission is expected to take significantly longer to reach the moon than Firefly's Boo Ghost. The Firefly's lander was placed in a highly elliptical Earth orbit, where it began a gradual orbital approach lasting 25 days before performing a translunar injection burn. In contrast, Resilience has opted for a more gradual lunar journey, utilizing a Falcon 9 upper stage to facilitate a low-energy transfer trajectory to the moon. Essentially, it will perform a lunar flyby, travel about 1 million miles into deep space, and then re-establish synchronization with the moon for its landing. Guerin explained that the minimal energy transfer allows us to trade off fuel to increase the payload capacity margin, ultimately resulting in an increased ability to reach the lunar surface. The lander is equipped with a variety of instruments, most notably a food production experiment and another aimed at demonstrating the process of electrolysis. Electrolysis has tremendous potential as it demonstrates the feasibility of producing rocket fuel on the moon. Guerin noted that the mission involves the deployment of a small rover called Tenacity, which will operate autonomously after landing. The rover is equipped with a high-definition camera that will be used to capture, among other things, visuals of an art installation known as the Moon House, a replica of a Swedish residence that will be placed on the lunar surface. Guerin said the rover is sourced from iSpace's European division. The rover plays a critical role in the future trajectory of our company, as its efficiency and the valuable data it produces will greatly assist us in refining our designs related to surface mobility, Guerin said. Therefore, this is indeed very exciting. The rover and lander are scheduled to function on the lunar surface for about 2 weeks, coinciding with the start of the moon's nocturnal phase. Guerin indicated that they are exploring a variety of methodologies to achieve this, from orbital solar solutions to nuclear alternatives and beyond. To build a cis-lunar economy, one must first demonstrate the ability to survive the night. There are millions of dollars allocated to these missions. That's it for today's episode. See you in the next episode.